periods and to have players under quarantine be moved to private houses with tennis courts so they can train. He denies being selfish and maintains he was only looking out for his fellow players. 72 players and staff have been confined for 2 weeks in hotels before the opening of the Australian Open after some people tested positive during a charter flight to Melbourne. In golf, Tiger Woods is out of the next two tournaments after undergoing another surgery for his back injury. The 15-time major champion said he underwent a procedure that removed a pressurized disc fragment that was pinching a nerve in his back. The operation will keep him sidelined for the next 2 months, but doctors are optimistic he will make a full recovery. Woods experienced back pains during his last month's PNC Championship. The latest operation is the 45-year-old American's fifth back surgery. The newly restored Metropolitan Theater is set to open this year. Jeffrey Arnaez gives us a look in this report.
The Manila Metropolitan Theater has deteriorated after decades of neglect. The building was vandalized. The stage where the biggest names in theater once performed turned into a shelter for the homeless. Previous administrations tried, but failed to revive the Met. The transfer of ownership of the theater.
This is the Philippines. We are ANC.
Newly installed U.S. President Joe Biden overturns some of the controversial policies of his predecessor on his first day in office. We'll have the president of Strat-based ADR Institute, Tindo Manhit, and Professor Herman Joseph Kraft of the Department of Political Science at the University of the Philippines to discuss how the U.S. and the world is going to shape up under the Biden presidency. Meanwhile, the Biden administration slams China for imposing sanctions on some Trump-era officials. Chinese billionaire Jack Ma resurfaces after disappearing from public view for several months. And Pfizer's COVID-19 vaccine appears to be effective against the more infectious UK variant. Good afternoon. I'm Carmina Constantino. Dateline Philippines begins right now. Good afternoon. Thanks for joining us. And for those of you watching us on YouTube and on Facebook, glad to have you with us today. A historic day in America as Joseph Robinette Biden Jr. was sworn in as the nation's 46th president. In his inaugural speech, Biden offered a message of unity and restoration to a deeply divided country. Our North America Bureau Chief TJ Manotok gives us the full story.
In front of just a small number of VIP guests that included former Presidents Barack Obama, Bill Clinton, and George W. Bush, history was made as Joe Biden and Kamala Harris took their oaths of office on the steps of the U.S. Capitol, just 2 weeks following the deadly insurrection by a Donald Trump-inspired mob that attempted to disrupt Congress from certifying their election victory.
I, Kamala Davie Harris, do solemnly swear
that I was Kamala Harris, who became the first woman, first South Asian, and first black woman Vice President of the United States, was up first. She was sworn in by Supreme Court Associate Justice Sonia Sotomayor, the first Hispanic and Latina member of the court.
I, Joseph Robinette Biden Jr., do solemnly swear
that
I
will. As Biden addressed the nation for the first time as president, he neither proclaimed victory for himself nor for his party, but for democracy.
This is America's day. This is democracy's day. A day of history and hope, of renewal and resolve through a crucible.
No threats to democracy.
The dream of justice for all will be deferred no longer. A cry for survival comes from the planet itself, a cry that can't be any more desperate or any more clear. And now, a rise of political extremism, white supremacy, domestic terrorism that we must confront and we will defeat.
Biden pledged, as he did in the past, to be a president for all Americans.
My whole soul is in this, bringing America together, uniting our people, uniting our nation. And I ask every American to join me in this cause.
After the inauguration, Biden immediately went to work, signing his first few official documents as president, including the inaugural declaration, cabinet nominations, and sub-cabinet nominations. Biden and Harris then participated in the military tradition, the pass-in-review, when service members first salute the newly sworn commander-in-chief. Biden takes office in an unprecedented time in history, as the country is in the midst of one of the deadliest pandemics of all time, an economic downturn, and a fractured society caused by great political divide.
The first order of business for President Joe Biden, undoing the legacy of his predecessor, Donald Trump. Our North America Bureau Chief TJ Manotok now joins us for more on Biden's first day in office. Good afternoon from Manila. TJ, go ahead.
Good evening from California, Carmina. And yes, you're right. He did so much work right away with a flurry of executive actions, 17 to be exact. You saw a bit of a glimpse of that, the stack of folders he had to sign right away. Of course, all these documents are already pre-prepared by his team days in advance, and literally they proved that they could hit the ground running. One of the most important executive actions he signed, of course, was his 100-day mask mandate challenge. He is mandating mask wearing now in all federal buildings that he has control over, and he's really strongly encouraging all governors and local officials to do the same, at least for the first 100 days, to prove a point that he can let science show that it does really make a big difference in denting the deadly curve that they are experiencing right now in the U.S. Another one, of course, was the fortifying of the DACA. This gives hope to a lot of the dreamers out there. We know a lot of Filipinos as well who are going to benefit from this, as their hopes of getting full citizenship was slowed down during the Trump administration and even potentially halted when it went to the Supreme Court. Another big one was the reversing the Muslim country travel ban. We know that President Trump did this in his first few days in office in 2016. We're in without any proof of any terrorist activity from certain countries. He just banned them, and he was criticized heavily for it being a racist ban just because those countries had Muslim-heavy populations. And another big one, of course, is the rejoining the Paris Climate Accord. And this is something that the Democrats really were pushing heavily for because they truly believe in fighting climate change. Republicans are not so much fans of that. And this is something that Joe Biden had promised from early on in his campaign he would do right away, and had done so as well. And another big one was returning to the fold with the WHO. Remember, Donald Trump in July of 2020 was so enraged against the World Health Organization, claiming that they were siding with China, claiming that they were allowing China to lie to them. And now Biden says, now more than ever, we need to work together. And he assigned an executive action, sent a letter to the World Health Organization today as well, just proclaiming that he is retracting the U.S. government's announcement that they are withdrawing from the WHO, and they are now back in the fold, and hopefully they can work hand-in-hand in beating this pandemic. Carmina?
Well, TJ, he did say prior to assuming office that he wanted to hit the ground running, and that he did. But talk to us now a bit about the inaugural program that happened after he was sworn into office, that program celebrating Americans and America and not necessarily the victory of Joe Biden. How did that resonate with most of the viewers there, TJ?
It was an incredible message, Carmina. I mean, he's the complete opposite of a boastful candidate who would just brag about the size of the crowd, brag about his victory. He did not even mention it whatsoever. He, right off the bat, one of the first things he said was, this is a victory for all Americans, victory for democracy. And of course, very timely, because democracy was challenged heavily in January 6th that cost the lives of 5 Americans right there in that same building at the U.S. Capitol. And just watching the reaction of people today here in the U.S. and social media, watching news commentaries, either from the left or the right, they like this message. They like this message of unity. They like this message that this is a victory for us, the country, and not for me and my party. And it's a good first start. Now, words are one thing, actions are another. So let's see if these words will be followed by actions in their legislative agendas and with whatever else they have to do in the next 100 days, as he's promised to make a serious dent in his first few months in office.
And that's what we're going to discuss with our guests later on in the program. Our North America Bureau Chief there, TJ Manotok. Thanks, TJ, for joining us today. You keep safe. Well, back here in the newsroom, Democrats take control of the U.S. Senate as Vice President Kamala Harris swore in 3 new members, giving the party a narrow grip on both houses of Congress. Democrats Raphael Warnock, John Ossoff, and Alex Padilla took their oath of office hours after Joe Biden was sworn in. Warnock and Ossoff won upset victories in a pair of runoff elections in Georgia on January 5th. Padilla was appointed to fill the Senate seat of Harris as she takes on the historic role as the first female vice president of the United States. The three Democrats give Biden a narrow edge to pursue his policies. The shift also makes Chuck Schumer the Senate majority leader, while Mitch McConnell was demoted to minority leader. Leaders around the world took to social media to welcome the Biden administration. On Twitter, British Prime Minister Boris Johnson said he looks forward to working with President Biden, noting that America's leadership is vital to all. French President Emmanuel Macron lauded Biden's move to bring the U.S. back to the Paris Climate Accord. As for Canadian Prime Minister Justin Trudeau, he noted the two countries' partnership in tackling history's greatest challenges, and he hopes to continue that relationship. Japanese Prime Minister Suga Yoshihide, meanwhile, hopes a free and open Indo-Pacific will be realized under a Biden administration. Also among those who sent in their well wishes on social media, Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu, Pakistan's Imran Khan, and the leaders of Ukraine and Chile. Over in Brussels, the European Union hailed the inauguration as a new dawn for Europe and the United States.
This time-honored ceremony on the steps of the U.S. Capitol will be a demonstration of the resilience of American democracy and the resounding proof that, once again, after four long years, Europe has a friend in the White House.
Pope Francis also commemorating the historic day in the U.S. The pontiff said he prayed that God will guide Biden's efforts to bring reconciliation in the U.S. and among nations. China expresses its willingness to cooperate with the U.S. under President Joe Biden. That is a parting shot to the Trump administration. Beijing has imposed fresh sanctions against outgoing U.S. Secretary of State Mike Pompeo, describing him as a lying and cheating official. Pompeo, along with 27 other Trump-era officials and their immediate family members, have been banned from entering mainland China, Hong Kong, or Macau. Companies and institutions associated with him are also restricted from doing business with China. The Biden administration slammed those actions, calling them unproductive. Biden's immigration policy is one of the most pressing matters that the Filipino-American community is watching out for. Philippine Ambassador to the U.S. Jose Romualdez says the PhilAm community is looking forward to the preservation of the Dreamers program. Former President Trump had tried to terminate the initiative during his term, putting more than 650,000 so-called Dreamers in limbo and in fear of deportation. Many of them are Filipino children. The Biden administration has moved swiftly to reverse this, proposing an immigration law that includes an immediate pathway to citizenship for the Dreamers.
What is the Filipino community looking forward to under a Biden presidency? What can change? Will immigration change, for example?
Yes, definitely. I think that that's one of the main or one of the first things that the Biden administration would like to do is to start bringing back, for instance, DACA and also the other visas that that will allow Filipinos to come here to study, to work here for 2 years after the H-1B visas. All of that will most likely come back. You know, the Democratic Party has always been known to believe that immigrants make a country or make the United has made the United States, and rightly so, because we have a lot of Filipino Americans here that have been very successful.
Well, as number 45 flew off to Florida and number 46 took his oath of office as the next president of the United States, between them, a reality that tells of a great divide of despair and anger, of a sigh of relief, a new dawn, of 400,000 lives lost to a pandemic still raging. Make no mistake about it. President Joseph Robinette Biden Jr. has a monumental task ahead of him. And joining us now to talk about what they think should be the first order of business and what a Biden presidency will and must look like, Dean Domanhit, he's president of Strat-based ADR Institute. Dindo joins us via phone and via Zoom. We have Professor Herman Kraft, Herman Joseph Kraft. He's chairman of the Department of Political Science at the University of the Philippines. Gentlemen, thank you for joining us today. Appreciate it. Welcome to the program.
Good afternoon, Carmina. Thank you for inviting me here.
All right. So I want to get your thoughts first on the speech that President Biden just gave. Did it project the right tone considering the current state situation that the U.S. finds itself in? Dindo, why don't you have a crack at that first?
Yes. Taking note of the statement of President Biden when he delivered his inaugural speech, he focused on identifying the challenge in front of him. He spoke of a domestic challenge. I think he was referring to the pandemic that continues really to haunt the United States, and also what he calls the democratic challenge. I think he's referring to what he inherited, a divided America, that we saw the peak of its division last week upon the encouragement of the outgoing president. And he built his speech around the tone of addressing this, finding solutions to it through unity. And that's something that he needs to build on. He has spent years working with the other side, the Republicans, when he was a senator. He brokered deals during the Obama administration. And so we're hoping that under his leadership, the United States is itself united to address these challenges and attain global leadership again.
I want to go to Professor Kraft now. What do you think about the tone that was projected in the inaugural speech?
Well, the tone is actually just right, I think, in terms of the idea of appealing, right, to the American people for unity. It's actually quite interesting that the way that he actually talked about and the kinds of words that he used, for instance, reflected back on, in fact, the speech made by Abraham Lincoln, for instance, during his first inaugural, the appeal to the better angels, for instance, now that's part of the speech that was made by President Biden today. If you're going to look at the first inaugural of Abraham Lincoln, now that was the end, that was the last line in his first inaugural, and that was the time when you're looking at the United States on the border. So basically, at one point, you can actually say that President Biden was trying to project optimism. Same time, there's also that wariness about where the amount of work that needs to be done. You know, that just talking about unity, so to speak.
Well, now that the inauguration is over and done with, Professor Kraft, what should be his first order of business? We do know that he signed a couple of documents there, 17, as our North America Bureau Chief did say. Is that going on the right track, do you think?
Well, I think it is, simply because one of the things that his administration didn't have was, of course, the transition. Right. If you remember, it's, you know, as far as preparations for the transition of the towards the Biden administration, and I think that created some delays in terms of preparations. Right. But in spite of that, and I think that's the reason why he promised that his administration would hit the ground running. And in spite of that, as you can see, there were 17 executive orders that were already prepared. So that the first order of business was for him to sign this. And interestingly, 9 of those was, of course, to reverse some decisions that were actually made by President Trump. So it's a good signal in terms of the idea that this administration is not taking it easy, you know, and which is also a recognition of the amount of work that actually needs to be done.
Yeah, and one of those things, Dindo, is that he still wants to be part of the WHO. But let's not forget the fact that the WHO is not without any faults as well. There was a paper that was recently published about how the WHO really failed to act quickly, swiftly enough to contain the spread of the virus. What do you think will a Biden presidency lend to the WHO as still being a part of it, Dindo?
Carmina, you have to look at it from really a broader and strategic perspective on the part of Biden, that he's someone who has built an agenda, an international agenda, that he wants to work with allies, that means among countries, and they would like to work with multilateral international institutions. So I think it's just...
He's been known to be that, right? He's known to be a team player. He's known to be one that forms consensus and works toward that. Do you think that this really sort of deflated the environment now with Trump gone and with Biden as the number four, the 46th president of the United States, Dindo?
I think the U.S. will be more respected by their traditional allies. I think it will be seen as a source of strength that they work with international organizations and different countries towards addressing, again, not only the issue of pandemic, but maybe moving forward, issues of rule-based international order, in security issues, or in trade issues. So I think it's a big step. Trump wanted to build it around his leadership as he viewed it, a strong one, but of course everybody saw it as really a dysfunctional leadership that maybe have affected even the respect of the world community again with the U.S. But now they see a new leader willing to work with everyone to address solutions to international challenges.
Yeah, but let's not look at this with rose-colored lenses. It's not going to be without challenges, right? And what will be those challenges? Go ahead.
Yeah, of course. We are still dealing with a global pandemic. We will deal with the economic consequences, the global economic consequences of this pandemic. So how to recover from it, how to help and show leadership among other countries, with other countries, working also with other countries to address these two challenges that is facing the world today. Then you see a rising China in the Pacific area, in our part of the world. But they speak of the challenges of bringing allies together to deal with China instead of simply a U.S.-China rivalry. So these are things that I think we need to watch on. We cannot really see how they will be successful, but I still see a better environment now more than where we are for the past 4 years. So I see things positively. Let's just hope that they can really bring people together, get their own domestic challenges on one hand, and start global leadership on the other hand.
Professor Kraft, let me go to you now. Tell us what's going for President Biden, though, that would make it relatively easy for him to face these challenges head on.
Well, the major issue actually for the Biden administration, and I think this is reflected in the inaugural address, right, is the issue of unity. And unity is not just a domestic issue. To a large extent, you might actually say that there was almost a sense of relief, right, in terms of the messages that came out of world leaders, right? But I think that sense of relief is not just about the idea that, you know, now we can go back to where we were before. Because
right.
Behind that is the recognition that within the United States, that division within American society is a significant challenge, you know, as far as the ability of President Biden to mobilize public support for the kinds of policies that he wants to actually push forward, which basically means that for world leaders, the question here is that will a Biden administration be able to bring the United States back to a place where it can be trusted again as the leader of the free world, so to speak, right? For it to take on that mantle once again. And I think there's still some sort of concern about the extent to which or how quickly a Biden administration would be able to do this.
Yeah, but it cannot be just because Trump is out and Biden is in, it cannot be that it's going to be business as usual if at all this pandemic has really exposed vulnerabilities
between and among all these countries. I mean, you talk about the rise of protectionism under Trump, and that sort of served the United States well when all the economies were shutting down in the middle of a raging pandemic. You talk about a place bringing the United States back to a place where it can be trusted. What kind of a place would that be, considering the rise of the vulnerabilities, the rise of protectionism, as opposed to globalization? What do you think about that, Professor Kraft? And Dido, I also want to get your thoughts on that. Go ahead, Professor Kraft.
Yeah, one of the things that the United States was actually, or at least the predictability of U.S. policy was based on, was its support for liberal economic, for a liberal economic order, which basically meant supporting world trade WTO rules. No, again, going back to what Dindo was saying about the rules-based order in the international system. And to a large extent, the Trump administration changed all of that in terms of how countries would actually look at the United States. No? The United States was always the main bulwark, if you will, that propped up this particular system. And taking it out of that basically meant that you had a problem as far as how that system would actually persist. So, which basically means that at this point in time, the promise being made by President Biden regarding a return to a multilateral order, support for multilateralism, support for and trying to do things together with allies rather than on a unilateral basis, no? And definitely taking a less transactional approach to cooperation, for instance, no? I think would be something that the Biden administration would actually be insistent on or trying to actually promote. And these are the kinds of steps that need to be taken if the United States is to regain fully the kind of trust that its allies need to have in American leadership.
Dindo, your thoughts on it? Business as usual? Should it go back to that pre-Trump business? Go ahead.
It's not really about business as usual. It's I agree with points raised by Professor Herman, and add that when I saw the reactions of global leaders, especially from allies in Europe, even in the Indo-Pacific region, how positive they viewed the victory or the election of Biden, and the transition team of Biden, and now in their statement that they would like to build on this partnership and election with the U.S. taking a leadership role, working with their partners, allies, then that can address some of these problems, and I think we can see something better moving in 2021.
Well, we know the rhetoric that Biden has been repeating. It's unity, it's hope, listening to each other again, seeing each other again. He's been saying that throughout the campaign trail and even during his inaugural speech. But having those translate into actual policies, Dindo, tell us about how you see him moving beyond the rhetoric.
It's reflective of his more than 40 years of public service in the U.S., role as a senator, as a vice president. He built it around that. So they built on his rhetoric was built around the character that people knew him in the U.S., especially in Washington, D.C., and how he acted even as a vice president for 8 years under former President Obama. So this kind of rhetoric will now be reflective of the cabinet that he brought in. That a cabinet that he brought in actually reflects America with a different cultural background, people of migrant families, and even the incoming State Department head, Tony Blinken, Filipinos should realize he actually developed the policy with former Secretary Albert Rosario, the freedom of navigation visits of the U.S. in West Philippine Sea in the 2015 era. So these are people who know how to work with allies and who will really push how these allies can work together to address common objectives or even facing problems. So it's built not only in him, but on the cabinet that he brought in.
Interesting point you made there, Dean, though some would have the rhetoric first and actions later. You just pointed out that it's his actions for decades of being a public servant that actually molded the rhetoric that he's saying now. Finally, I want to go to Professor Kraft. Beyond the rhetoric, beyond the heartwarming inauguration program, what does a Biden presidency signal to the whole world?
Not exactly the point that you were making earlier about business as usual, but that we're now going back. The signaling is that the United States is again ready to take its place in an international system where it has traditionally had a leadership role, and that in this context, actually, it promises that it would behave in a much more predictable way, you know, as opposed to the kinds of chaos, if you will, that the Trump administration seemed to thrive on, you know, as far as its relationships with its traditional allies is actually concerned.
Mm. At the very least, I think people, whether world leaders or otherwise, are just breathing easier today.
Yeah, that's right.
All right. Professor Herman Kraft, Chairman of the Political Science Department of the University of the Philippines, thank you for joining us today. Appreciate you joining us. And also
thank
Dean Domenhit, President of Strat-Base ADR Institute, joining us via phone. Thanks, Dean, though. You keep safe.
Thank you. Bye-bye, everyone.
All right, we're going to take a break now. Still ahead, parts of Marikina underwater again following nonstop rains overnight. And also later, the Brooklyn Nets get Kyrie Irving back. But their Big Three era got off to a bumpy start. This is Dateline Philippines. Stay with us here on ANC. We'll be right back.
You have to be a working manager and a leader at the same time. Your team will only do as you do and not as you say. So it's very important to set the right example.
People who are in the leadership sector should be able to walk the talk. You cannot preach about sustainability without making sacrifices, small sacrifices in your lifestyle. That's the key. It will redound to the individual behavior of the people preaching and of the people actually following.
Authentic community. By focusing on that particular core value, a lot of these Gen Zs and millennials can be themselves. They don't have to pretend anymore. As we prioritize the voices and the feedback of our young,
here's another look at our headlines this noon. Newly installed U.S. President Joe Biden overturned some of the controversial policies of his predecessor on his first day in office. Meanwhile, the Biden administration slams China for imposing sanctions on some Trump-era officials. Chinese billionaire Jack Ma resurfaces after disappearing from public view for several months. And Pfizer's COVID-19 vaccine appears to be effective against the more infectious UK variant. Back with more news. The COVID-19 vaccine developed by Pfizer and BioNTech appears to be effective against the more infectious variant discovered in the UK. Details in this report.
The Pfizer and BioNTech COVID-19 vaccine is likely to protect against the more infectious variant of the virus, which was discovered in Britain, according to results of further lab tests released on Wednesday. The encouraging results from an analysis of blood of participants in trials are based on more extensive analysis than those released by the drug maker last week. In those tests, Pfizer said a similar lab study showed the vaccine was effective against one key mutation that's found in both of the highly transmissible new variants spreading rapidly across Britain and South Africa. The latest study, which was posted online but is yet to be peer-reviewed, was conducted on a synthetic virus with 10 mutations that are characteristic of the variant known as B117, identified in Britain. Among the 11 authors of the study are the co-founders of BioNTech. It provides further hope as record numbers of daily deaths from COVID-19 are reported in Britain, which is believed to be driven by the more transmissible variant. It also means vaccine development would, for now, not have to start all over again.
And we have this just in. An India-based biotech firm has applied for emergency use authorization in the Philippines for its COVID-19 vaccine. Our correspondent Christine Sabilio now on the line to tell us more about this. Christine, what else can you tell us?
Carmina, the Food and Drug Administration confirmed today that India-based Bharat Biotech has applied for emergency use authorization in the Philippines for its COVID-19 vaccine. FDA Director General Eric Domingo told ABS-CBN News that the company submitted its application this morning and they are still undergoing pre-evaluation. Vaccine Czar Secretary Carlito Galvez said also this morning that Bharat Biotech vaccine is indeed one of those being considered for procurement by the country, but he said they have yet to see the results of its clinical trials. IP Biotech and Ambika International, which have an exclusive agreement with Bharat Biotech to distribute Covaxin, that's the name of the vaccine, also released a statement confirming their application with the FDA. Covaxin was developed by Bharat in collaboration with the Indian Council for Medical Research, National Institute of Virology. It is an inactivated virus vaccine that comes in two doses and can be kept in a standard cold chain temperature of 2 to 8 degrees Celsius. According to the group, the Philippines is on its list of priority countries. An Associated Press report recently cited Bharat Biotech advising those with weak immunity, allergies, and bleeding disorder to not take the vaccine. The same report said Bharat Biotech was involved in controversy after the Indian government allowed its use without an efficacy rate. The company said in another report that it will release its efficacy data by March. And previous reports said the company plans to produce 700 million vaccine doses this year. That's the latest on vaccine applications here in the country. Back to you, Carmina.
Thanks a lot, Christine Sabilio there. You keep safe, Christine. And back here in the newsroom, COVID-19 vaccines from the World Health Organization's COVAX facility are expected to arrive within the first quarter of this year. That's according to Vaccine Chief Carlito Galvez. He said the Philippines is set to receive 30 to 40 million of these vaccines after the COVAX facility confirmed the country's participation last Wednesday. The COVAX facility had previously said it will distribute Pfizer vaccines to developing nations. Philippine vaccine officials are already preparing the country's cold storage facilities ahead of the arrival of these vaccines.
We have adequate cold storage capacity for all types of COVID vaccines. Tiningnan namin talaga yung dalawang facilities ng Unilab and also RITM and also yung Swilig, pati yung packaging nila, yung magkakaroon ng tinatawag na transport, lahat.
The Makati Shangri-La Hotel is closing its doors temporarily effective February 1st this year, citing the impact of the pandemic on the travel and hospitality industry. The hotel says it has implemented salary reductions at the management level and provided assistance to its rank-and-file employees for the past 10 months. But the pandemic has resulted in increasing financial pressure on the company. The hotel adds it has decided to reorganize its workforce and will be letting go of some employees. The hotel vows to reopen the property when business conditions improve. As the Philippines deals with its with shrinking supply of pork, another problem arises. A local group of broiler raisers warning of a looming shortage of chicken. Let's hear more from April Rafales.
The country's problem on the shortage of pork supply is far from over. Hog raisers, whose businesses have been hit by the African swine fever, are still struggling to recover. Pork prices have spiked. A kilo of pork belly, which used to retail for 250 pesos last year, is now at 400 pesos or higher in Metro Manila. The Philippine Agriculture Department has sought to bring pork supply from Visayas and Mindanao to Metro Manila. The agency is also fast-tracking the arrival of some 54,000 metric tons of imported pork from ASF-free countries.
We mobilized natin noong 2020. Dito lang naman sa 2021, ay magbibigay na kami ng import clearance para maparating na agad itong late February and Marso, itong mga galing sa ibang bansa.
The United Broiler Raisers Association, for its part, warns of a looming shortage of chicken, which is currently the alternative source of protein for most consumers. This is because many broiler raisers have shifted to egg production.
Yung mga nalugi sa pagbababoy at nalugi sa pagbabroiler ay naglipata ng marami dyan at ginakabahan na nga yung mga small and medium sa egg industry dahil ang lalaki ng mga naglipatan. Dati yan, ang isang bahay, 6,000 ang laman. Ngayon, kung magpagawa ngayon sa layer industry, 50,000. May climate control facilities pa.
The farm gate price of chicken also went up by 30 pesos per kilo compared to 2019.
Po ay indikasyon na kulang na ho talaga ang kakayahan ng broiler industry. Sa ngayon, no, kinakaya pa dahil record nga high nga yung pinanggalingan. Pag nagsimula na siguro magbakuna, pag tumaas ang kumpiyansa ng tao, maglalabasan na, kakain na sa labas, matatagdagan yung pressure sa industriya.
Samahang Industriya ng Agrikultura Chairman Rosendo So said, the government must strengthen local production of other sources of protein instead of simply resorting to importation.
Mahirap mag-asa sa other countries kasi kung makita ng other countries, maliit yung production natin, itataas din yung presyo kasi negosyo yun .
Meanwhile, the Department of Trade and Industry and Department of Agriculture are now running after unscrupulous retailers. More than 1,000 vendors were given notices for overpricing. The agencies are also looking at making overpricing traders accountable.
It's a range of those violators. Mostly muna yung vendors. Our heightened alert in terms of looking at traders and wholesalers, yun ang susunod po namin na sila kasi yung masyadong nagmamanipula ng presyo dito sa mga wet market.
The Philippine Price Act, however, precludes this as the law does not oblige traders to follow suggested retail prices. For now, the Agriculture Department is eyeing the possibility of adjusting the current suggested retail prices for basic agriculture products.
Definitely, we are going, now that's under review, we are going to adjust the SRP as soon as possible. Wala kasi yan sa ating batas. We have to, that's why there is a move now to amend the Price Act.
The agency is also encouraging local price coordinating councils of local government units to monitor and castigate those who are guilty of overpricing. April Rafales, ABS-CBN News.
U.S. stocks surged to record highs Wednesday as Joe Biden was sworn in as America's 46th president. The Dow rose 257 points, while the S&P 500 closed at 3851. The Nasdaq was the biggest gainer, adding 260 points.
The market rally comes despite Wall Street's initial hesitance to Biden due to his plans to reverse some of former President Donald Trump's pro-business corporate tax cuts. But now, Milken Institute fellow Curtis Shin says corporate America is really just relieved about the peaceful transition of power.
Business, for the most part, wants stability. Certainly, they appreciated President Trump's reduction of regulations. But I think business will also welcome this notion of a more collegial, inclusive approach to issues like trade and economic affairs. We're very much focused, of course, on equity markets, and the numbers continue to look terrific, you know, from investors' viewpoints. But we also need to think about, are those numbers sustainable if we don't address these issues of inequality and inequity in America?
Investors also betting on economic recovery on the back of a faster COVID-19 vaccine rollout and a bigger $1.9 trillion pandemic relief plan under the Biden administration. The founder of Alibaba Group, Jack Ma, resurfaces after disappearing from public view for nearly 3 months. Ma met 100 rural teachers in China via a live video meeting on Wednesday from a living room. He did not give hints about where he was since he supposedly went missing last October. He just said he would meet the teachers again after the pandemic. This ends countless speculations about his whereabouts since he blasted China's regulatory system during his speech at a forum. Because of his reappearance, shares of the e-commerce giant in Hong Kong jumped by over 10%. Well, back here at home, hundreds of residents in Marikina City have been evacuated from their homes as nonstop rains overnight triggered flooding near the Marikina River. The river's water level reached 16 meters at around 4 in the morning, causing floods up to 3 stories high, prompting officials to raise a second alarm. The alert has since been downgraded to a first alarm. Marikina Mayor Marcelino Teodoro now calling for the dredging of the heavily silted Marikina River.
Yung aking panawagan niya, kabayan, sana nga madredge natin agad ang Marikina River sa tulong ng national government natin, particular DPWH. At sana mailabas na ng DNR yung kanilang resolution tungkol dun sa reclamation o dun sa aming final na petition para malaparan ang Marikina River.
And let's get an update on the weather now from PAGASA forecaster Anna Clorin. Anna, go ahead.
Yes, good afternoon. At 10 a.m. today, the low pressure area was located at around 190 kilometers south-southwest of Puerto Princesa City, Palawan. The said weather disturbance is less likely to develop into a tropical cyclone. In the next 24 hours, moderate to heavy rains with at times intense rains are expected over Isabela and the eastern portion of mainland Cagayan, the northern and central portions of Aurora. Moderate to heavy rains are expected over the rest of Cagayan Valley and Aurora. Meanwhile, light to moderate to at times heavy rains are expected over Cordillera and Estivillo, Nueva Ecija, the northern portion of Quezon, including Polillo Islands, and the southern portion of Palawan, including Balabac Island. Possible flash floods or landslides due to moderate to at times heavy rains are possible. Meanwhile, here in Metro Manila, mostly cloudy skies. We are expecting a mostly cloudy skies with isolated rain showers or thunderstorms, also due to the tail end of the frontal system. The rest of the country will generally have fair weather condition aside from isolated rain showers, mostly in the afternoon or in the evening. It is due to the localized thunderstorm. We have gale warning raised over the seaboards of Batanes, Cagayan, including Babuyan Islands, Ilocos Norte, and Ilocos Sur. Fishing boats and other small sea crafts are advised not to venture out into the sea, while larger sea vessels are alerted against big waves. And that's the latest from PAGASA. Anna Clorin reporting.
Thanks a lot, Anna. Keep safe. Back here in the newsroom, some sports action. NBA All-Star Kyrie Irving returned from his self-imposed hiatus, but his comeback wasn't enough to lift the Brooklyn Nets past the Cleveland Cavaliers. The star-studded Nets bowed to the Cavs, 147-135 in double overtime. Colin Sexton made a clutch three-pointer to send the game into the second extra session. He then made mincemeat out of Irving's defense in the second overtime to finish
with 42 points. Irving had 37 points in his return to action, while fellow Big Three members Kevin Durant and James Harden had 38 points and a triple-double, respectively. It was their first game together since the Nets acquired Harden in a blockbuster deal from Houston. Two ABS-CBN shows will be simulcast on TV5 beginning January 24th. Asap Natin To, the Philippines' longest-running musical variety show, will be seen on the Kapatid Network starting Sunday. The show, which was launched in 1985, brings together some of the Kapamilya Network's biggest performers, including Martin Rivera, Jaja Padilla, and Gary Valenciano. FBJ Daking, a movie block showcasing the films of the late Philippine cinema icon Fernando Po Jr., will also air on TV5 every Sunday from 2 to 4 in the afternoon. Signal and TV5 President and CEO Robert Galang said this collaboration marks the start of greater cooperation between the two networks to be able to serve Filipino viewers in the best way possible. Good news. And that'll do it for today. Thank you for joining us. I'm Permina Constantino. If you want to revisit today's episode, Dateline Philippines podcast is on Spotify and Apple Podcasts. Playback this newscast too on ANC's YouTube channel and on ANC 24/7 on Facebook. Keep safe. Keep it here on ANC.
And a brand new normal. This is what this season is all about. Let us bring you back to the most gorgeous places we can only dream of. Trending with